The AIDS epidemic stirs up many emotions, including, unfortunately, guilt and self-hatred, feelings many gay men have never conquered. We really need to beware of these old enemies when deciding how healthy men should deal with the possibility of getting the disease. There is a consensus among gay physicians. Most healthy men I know are acting on it, as am I. Those with ongoing sexual relationships are being more strictly monogamous. Those who are single have cut out anonymous sex and are more careful about the men they have sex with when they date. But they do continue to date, in many cases precisely because they're looking for permanent monogamous relationships. We also hear some more hysterical voices. They come from a tiny group of men, some of whom have AIDS. AIDS patients I know from my work with the gay men's health crisis don't agree with them. They say the only responsible alternative to monogamy is virtual celibacy. We who don't have lovers are told that we have to give up sex because of a new brand of ethics invented by this self-appointed group. Who are these men? I don't think their names are important, but their histories are. For example, one is a former hustler, an S&M hustler who provided pain for a price. This man probably had more sexual contacts in 1 year than I did in 10. He's not someone who's going to lay down the ethical agenda for my future. The same man once told me I'm a fool for continuing to have sex with men I date. Then he lit a cigarette. According to the American Cancer Society, 80,000 men died in 1982 from diseases caused by cigarette smoking. That means roughly 88,000 gay men died in 1 year. Contrast that to the entire AIDS caseload, which amounts to about 1,000. Yet the man who wants to impose celibacy on me smokes. Interesting. I'm a gay man. It took me years to bring myself to say that openly and with pride. Certainly, my sexuality is only a part of my gayness, but it is the central part. If I can't join another man's body to mine, then how am I gay? Liking Bette Midler isn't enough. Make no mistake, I know about this disease, and I know it may strike me tomorrow. I'm scared. The crucial question is, how will I let my fear affect me? I know what I won't do. I won't give up the physical expression of intimacy. And in my sexual encounters, we won't start out with a health quiz, nor will we limit our lovemaking to certain acts. I refuse to treat my partner as a sick person or to present myself as one. That's the trip that Socarides and Bryant and Falwell have tried to lay on us. I'm not going to lay it on myself. To act otherwise, to give up sexual communication out of the fear of physical illness and death, is really to embrace another kind of death. The death of wholeness, the death of the spirit, in fact, the death of the self.